directing Rise of the Guardians seems a bit like having to direct the Avengers Assemble without the previous four films. Because you've got all these huge characters you need to introduce and the world. Was that daunting for you?
Maybe a little bit, but I think what we really wanted to do was make sure that all of these characters got moments in the film and that we could meet them in the middle of the story as we went along and paint the picture as we went, which is why it was really important having a character who could be an audience surrogate, like Jack Frost. We travel with him. He's kind of the eyes of the audience. He's kind of the soul of the audience. And his interrelationships with the characters kind of teach us everything we need to know about them and hint at their histories and their own relationships. So I think that was kind of our basic thesis.
And you've got all the main kind of mythical characters in there. Did you have a favorite growing up? And did how you felt about them influence the portrayal in the film?
Yeah, probably. I mean, you know, Santa Claus is always the big one. I mean, Christmas, that's, when we talk about believing in these characters, that's the first one you reference. But I also believed in the Tooth Fairy and Easter Bunny. And, you know, I got little quarters, you know, under my pillow and the whole deal. But Santa's the one. He's the big one.
And there was talk about William Joyce co-directing the film for a while. How heavily involved did he get in that kind of side of things?
You know, I think very early on that was kind of the original intention. But, you know, Bill also runs his own company on the side, and he was busy with the writing of the book, so I think life kind of caught up with him, and he wasn't able to ever get into the co-directing thing. However, he consulted with us very closely. I mean, particularly early on, you know, we'd show him artwork all the time, script pages. He'd give us notes on all the screenings, so he was a creative partner. A complete creative partner, particularly in the early going.
I really love the Yetis, especially. Mm-hmm. Where did they come from? Were they really from his side, or was that a bit of Guillermo del Toro getting involved? Or?
Yeah, the Yetis were straight out of Bill's books, straight out of... it was his idea that Santa had, you know, these kind of big burly helpers, these big retainers, and that they were the ones who actually made the toys. And in the movie, we kind of pushed that a little further and made them these kind of finicky craftsmen who did all the stuff while the elves just are troublemakers, basically.
And the books that Joyce wrote, they weren't set in the modern day. What was behind the decision to change that for the film?
You know, it was kind of part of the plan. Bill had this notion that he wanted to devote his books to the backstory and the mythology and the history, but that any movie, rather than being a straight adaptation of those, would be hundreds of years later when all these characters had already been established and they all got together for the first time. And I think his thinking was that he'd always felt that straight adaptations came up short, that you always had to leave something out of the books or they weren't a complete experience, and why not just bypass that altogether? And I think for a movie like this, you know, you would have to shortchange some of the characters if you wanted to spend time telling all their stories. So this way, telling the story of Jack Frost and meeting the other characters through him seemed to be the kind of the smartest way to do it.
And as well as directing it, you did a little bit of voice acting in it as well, as you did for Monsters vs. Aliens,
right,
Pumpkins one. So do you really just want to be an actor?
Well, you know, I think every director is probably a frustrated actor deep inside. But yeah, I didn't get as much as I did in the Pumpkins movie. I think I'm just some guy on a street in this. I had to get in there somehow.
And will there be a sequel?
You know, one can only hope. There's a lot more stories we could tell. There's so much from Bill's books, and there's also so much that I think just our movie kind of suggests. And you know, there's no end to the ideas you could have. But it all depends on the audience whether or not they believe.
I'm wondering how you'd go about naming the sequel. Would it be Rise Again, Rise of the Planet of the Guardians?
Yeah, I know. Like, Fall of the Shift Sideways of the Guardians. I don't know. That's a tough one.
And was it fun just being able to portray these famous characters in a slightly darker way than I think a lot of people know them as?
Yeah. It was a lot of fun, and I don't know that they are necessarily darker. I mean, there is an edge of darkness in the story, like there is in all good, you know, kids' stories and fables. But I don't think the Guardian characters themselves are dark at all. I mean, the interesting thing to me is when you first meet them, they're shocking because they're very different than what you'd imagine. But as the movie goes on, I think you kind of see, oh, they do exactly what I always thought they did. You know, they're the same characters I always loved. I was just forced to step to the side and take another look at them from a different angle.